The NHL season has had some interesting revelations. Scoring is up across the league. The game is as fluid and fast-paced as ever. Yet the Eastern Conference hasn't really brought us any surprises. It's been mostly as expected, barring an aberration or two. Doesn't mean that there isn't tension around every corner. 16 teams. What do they bring? Please don't tell me Boston forgot they had more than one line again. To be fair, it's a really good line. Pasta, Bergeron, and Marchand still performing at an elite level. The goaltending is too. The issue is that the rest of the team is sputtering around. David Backes has faded to the point where he has become a healthy scratch. The other three lines a constant shuffle to see if something congeals. The Bruins are a tough team to decipher. Yes, the outlying totals look good, but when you dig deeper, you see the team's issues. In particular, they've been dealing with a lot of injuries. Significant ones to a strong majority of the core. No wonder why they can't get any strong traction on the season. The train breaks before it can start. I think we can safely say that we are at or near the end times. The Buffalo Sabres are not a steaming pile of shit. It's the first time these words can be uttered about them in years. The Jeff Skinner trade has been a boon as he is already a 30-goal scorer. Only problem is that he's a free agent at the end of the year. Nice time to have a career season. Sam Reinhardt and the Rasmus pairing have been developing nicely, giving them a solid core for the future. The main problem for them now is that their hot start has tapered off. They have been struggling mightily again, in no part thanks to the team depth imitating Patrick Berglund and no-showing most nights. Carter Hutton is back to his average self and no longer playing eons over his head. I mean, even if you don't make the playoffs again, at least you're not a drama-filled plane crash. If that's a positive.
Good news, Raleigh, I've been rehired by this fine organization. Everything is coming up brass bonanza for the Hurricane. The team is loaded with sexy talent. Our farm system is stronger than ever. We're analytical darlings. We have an outside chance of clinching a wild card berth.
At this point, I must announce that the Hurricanes still do not have reliable goaltending, regret the Jeff Skinner trade, and Jordan Staal is in an injury-filled year.
But who wants to hear negative things? Let's bring back the Whalers uniform. Brass bonanza rings throughout the arena as the fans are slowly starting to come back to our team. This calls for a celebration. Please rise for our national anthem. Keep coming to our game.
The Jackets are about where I expected them to be at the start of the year. Near the top of the Metro in a dogfight for playoff positioning. There is some good news, though. Pierre-Luc Dubois is blossoming into the first-line center this organization needs. The team isn't completely wrecked health-wise so far. But beyond this unassuming playoff-contending exterior, many problems are beginning to bubble over. Artemi Panarin is hell-bent on testing free agency in the summer. His talents will not subside in Columbus for long. The bigger issue, though, is with Bobrovsky. Turns out he's been ruffling management's feathers a little too much, culminating in being benched and Bob gung-ho to flee Columbus. The team will be all too happy to oblige his request. With Corpusalo still a question mark, this could be a huge issue. But they could get an interesting return for him, especially with the dearth of goaltending talent on certain teams. Every move is critical. Anything to do something in the playoffs besides get eliminated. Well, Detroit, the inevitable happened. You are near the nadir of many years of trying to keep the streak alive. The Red Wings are circling the drain, dealing with the end of many old contracts that have held them back. It's not that they're eager to keep trotting Nicholas Cronwall as a first-pairing defenseman, it's that they don't have a choice. Who else is there? The sad declines of Jonathan Erickson and Trevor Daley? The only things keeping them in any way competitive are Jimmy Howard and a sprinkling of Dylan Larkin. There isn't much to hope for at this point, besides waiting for Philip Zadina. This may suck, Detroit, but this is for your own good. A rebuild is what has been needed for years, and perhaps bottoming out will force them to stop with the half measures. I would be hopeful for your deadline, but then you realize that Ken Holland happened, and a lot of your players have been signed to no trade clauses. Even the rentals. All you can do is pray that Gustav Nyquist waves his and gets a return rivaling Tatar's. Every time you think the Florida Panthers are going to bust through that wall with the impressive core that they have, they trip on a tree branch. The NHL is Lucy, they are Charlie Brown. You do the math. The main issue hasn't been the once-again awful depth. It hasn't been an underachieving defense. It hasn't even been the long-term injury to Vinny Trocheck. Your Achilles heel this season has been goaltending. We must admit a sad truth. Bobby Lou is slowly dying. Injuries and age have beaten his once proud abilities to a shell of what they were. And with the run of form he was on at the end of last year, it's another bad omen for the team. For those of you asking, James Reimer hasn't been doing any better. In fact, I dare say he's been significantly worse than Luongo. The Panthers are once again in another dire situation. Do they gamble on overpaying at the deadline for goalie help, or do they strip down and sell off pieces? With the years of stagnation, it's not looking good either way, and it may result in Dale Talon being legitimately fired instead of fucked around with. The wonderful time of the year where I get to point and laugh at Bergevin. It's one of my most cherished narratives in the hockey sphere. Look at all of those terrible moves he made this offseason. Trading Galchenyuk for an unproven scorer in Max Domi, who's probably turned into a massive success. But wait, that was when they undressed Patches repeatedly and traded him for goddamn Tomas Tatar, who's returned to form. What about Jesperi Kotkaniemi? He's showing incredible promise. But Shea Weber and Carey Price, they can't stay healthy as they revive as the franchise cornerstones. Doesn't mean that the Canadiens are a fast, youthful team fighting for playoff contention. Did Bergevin just pull his ultimate Bergevin? Laughable move after laughable move to turn the Habs into a decent team? To the relief of haters, there are some moves he's made that are killing them. Carl Alsner has been a disaster, but I'm still interested to see how they play moving forward. The only thing missing is a really cute puppy. You win this round, Mark. Leave it to the Devils to take a surprise playoff run and transform it into another disappointing realization that there is still much work to be done. The goaltending in particular needs an infusion of talent. Corey Schneider wore out from carrying years of terrible teams and has fallen off a cliff. Keith Kincaid, a backup forced to play way too much. Mackenzie Blackwood's been a nice jolt in the arm, but there still isn't enough on the team to push them forward. They need more. Which was why standing pat in the offseason was either a sign of overconfidence or that management knew the Devils weren't truly ready. Especially with Taylor Hall nursing an injury that's kept him out for a while, it's fourth down and New Jersey may just be punting the season. The key from them is development, and there just hasn't been enough of it from their youth. In this regard, the year has been a failure. Back to square one, boys. I remember a lot of people perplexed as to why I would choose the Islanders for a playoff spot over teams like the Devils and Flyers. To many in the hockey world's amazement, Long Island's finest have emerged as a legitimate playoff contender. Although first in the Metro wasn't what I had in mind, my reasoning for being high on them is one simple reason. Coaching. I'm not the biggest Barry Trotz fan, but I must acknowledge, no matter where he goes, he has always gotten more with less. It happened in Nashville for years, it happened with the Capitals last season, and now it's happening with the New York Islanders. They don't wow you in terms of their talent, but they're playing like a team. Trotz has gotten them to buy into his system. It's something they've lacked for a very long time. Competence at the top. Is it sustainable for the rest of the year? Who knows? Robin Lehner is playing some outstanding hockey, and he will be the key for them moving forward. It's such a relief from dealing with the perennial snow mismanaging everything. Welcome to Rebuilding, Rangers. As the teasings of your former Field Cup window continue to peek around every corner, you get to experience the struggles and frustrations of trying to find your new core. In the meantime, witness the sad fall of King Henrik as he attempts to salvage the team season, despite the defending the team does in front of him. The quotes were deliberate. The Sivs they call defensemen, among other things, has predictably resulted in yet another collapsing team in MSG. The only option for them now is to completely embrace the suck. Finish off the blow-up. There's going to be a lot of familiar faces that go, but it's for the best. There will be no winning with whatever core you have left. Not without a miracle. Maybe you can even get rid of Mark Stahl with his terrible contract and no movement clause for two more years. Yep, you're still fucked there. Hey, look, a puppy! This is a team. That is the only positive of them. To the surprise of absolutely no one, the Senators are an eternal dumpster fire both on and off the ice. It's nothing to do with the offense. They can score goals with a good bit of their talent. The issue is in your entire back end. It is nowhere near NHL caliber. And that's probably putting it nicely. The defensemen are guys that are either young and terrible or older and terrible. Calling Cody Ceci a pylon is an insult to the pylon. There is much more immolation going on there. The goaltending isn't much better off. Five different starters on the year, most of them horrific between the pipes. Not content with being a disaster on the ice, the only thing notable about their penalty kill was a fucking leaked conversation in an Uber. They also couldn't block that from getting on net. At least that conversation had more bite than fucking Melnick, who couldn't keep his paws away from a gift situation and completely fucked another arena proposal. This organization has become an embarrassment to the league, and they need to strip it from Melnick as soon as possible before this black eye becomes even more noticed. At the very least, they can try to tank and get the first over... Oh, right. They can't. Their first round pick is Avalanche property. Remember when we said it couldn't get worse? Ignore that, because it always does. What you are hearing from the southeastern part of Pennsylvania is the sound of a half-assed rebuild getting a bottle rocket shoved up its ass and fired into Jersey so it can rot in Camden. This team is a joke. It may have to do with the fact that they kept Dave Haxtell for way too long before firing him. Or it could have been when it was leaked that they hired Coach Q, only for it to be flatly denied. What it probably really is due to is the completely embarrassing situation in their crease. 7 different goaltenders starting for them throughout the year. For reference, most teams are alarmed if they start 4 per season. Many of them are such trash that they would make a post-Super Bowl Philly look respectable. Even more embarrassingly, things have gotten so bad that they've had to rush their golden goose Carter Hart so they could at least feign hope that the season could be salvaged. With their much ballyhooed defensive prospects struggling to develop in this environment, this could be getting really ugly for them. As a result of this failure to unrealistically fence it for upper management, Ron Hextall was told to fuck off since he can't go out there himself. Now they get Chuck Fletcher, whom led to the success of the Minnesota Wild. You know where I'm probably going with this. Things aren't going to change here until the boys' club at the top is overthrown via bloody coup. Most likely, that is not happening. At least the rest of the Metro likes you guys being down there. The Penguins are the tale of two teams. First, they are the fucking Penguins. A team that looks old and slow, featuring Matt Murray becoming a hot mess, Casey DeSmith bailing the team out repeatedly, and everyone wondering if they were entering the dreaded Blackhawks territory. After that, they become the fucking Penguins. A team looking much more rejuvenated, getting scoring from depth players again, Matt Murray returning to form after a stint on IR, and rattling off wins to get back in the thick of the hunt. There have been good revelations. Chris Letang is no longer complete ass. His more aggressive style of play has returned him to the elite form he was at a few seasons ago and has arguably been the best player on the team. The only real gripe I had was with misusing Daniel Sprong, but that wasn't a real place for him, and Marcus Patterson has been a decent pickup so far. Although, can someone get Evgeny Malkin off the schneid? Also, please send Derek Brassard into the sun of Arizona. And someone get a flux capacitor so we can undo the Jack Johnson signing. He's garbage? My god, it's like we were all saying when they announced it! There are two types of teams in the NHL this season. The Tampa Bay Lightning, and everyone else. This team is on a completely different stratosphere, flying higher than the gods themselves. Everything is clicking as it should in Amalie Arena. Nikita Kucherov has transcended the spiritual plane like few before him and has had a season for the ages. Braden Point is also having himself a career year, ironically just in time for his first big boy contract. A quick hint for their opponents: do not take penalties against them, their power play will kill you 6 times over. Even then, this is going to be the part where I become the glass half empty kind of guy and say that you need to win a cup this year. You've spent too much time floundering in the playoffs and this is your true test. Shit or get off the pot. Cap hell will be fast approaching. There are many others besides Point that will be due for significant raises this year and next. In reality, the fanbase will ignore this and continue to demand Vasilevsky's head on a silver platter. The regular season success is hollow. Playoff time is when it will matter for the Lightning. The Toronto Maple Leafs, with huge expectations placed upon them by the media and fanbase alike after a significant offseason. John Tavares performing exactly as advertised. He doesn't even need pajamas to perform as a Leaf. Freddie Anderson putting on a show in net to prove his case for the Vezina. Hell, you even got William Nylander back in the fold. Doing next to nothing and creating another dilemma this offseason with Marner and Matthews' contracts expiring, but that's not important right now. On paper, everything seems perfect for Toronto to end their half-century curse. However, the devil is in the defense. In particular, your right-hand side. I hate to say it, but Ron Hainsey should not be a first-bearing defenseman on a Stanley Cup team, random year in Pittsburgh aside. The fans will demand more, especially as they haven't been as successful as the hype. It's a Maple Leaf tradition to ignore their issues and roast the ever-loving shit out of some of their top defenders. Jake Gardner, welcome to the club, buddy! Larry Murphy and Brian McCabe made a nice fruit basket for you to enjoy in the locker room. How thoughtful of them. The Capitals spent the summer partying it up, but there appears to be no Stanley Cup hangover in sight. Well, there was early in the season, but they quickly shed it off and have been rejuvenated. In fact, it may have been the best thing for them. They just feel more relaxed in the way they play. I don't know if it has to do with the new coach or getting the monkey off their backs. Yes, Alex Ovechkin is still God. He's got his spot on the power play. He rips the slap shot that no one can stop. There are a few holes that still need to be patched up, but the core is performing as advertised. Hell, even Tom Wilson is playing like a legit first liner. Well, when he isn't making borderline hits at least twice a month. I'd probably like him more if he stopped that shit. Would that make sense? Nah, I gotta see Ryan Reeves beat the shit out of him. The only thing that could make this better is another skid. You have no idea how cathartic this is. As the season continues on its beaten path, I have a philosophy about predictions at this point in time. I don't do them. The NHL is a game of ebbs and flows, and for the most part, anything I say would be a glorified guessing game. You all know how poorly I do with those. I will stop while I'm ahead. Happy playing, boys. I'll see you all at the deadline.
Last February. coin. In the home stretch. 14.346. She beat her.